All right, so here's a trick that's been recommended. Can the people in the back hear me? And can you clap if you can? All right, see? And then everyone starts to clap and bees quiet. Karen, let's see. Thanks for the tip. Okay. So real quick reminders, lunch 1 hour long. We will resume at 2:30. So please try to make it back on time. And remember, there's vegan and vegetarian and gluten-free options across the street that way over at the Hyatt. Okay, so now we're going to get going with our next speaker. I'd like to introduce Sharna Prasad, who has been a PT for 32 years. She is currently working out of Lebanon Community Hospital in Oregon, where she specializes in pelvic floor and persistent pain therapy. She is the co-founder of Mid Valley Pain Alliance, an alliance of healthcare providers and community volunteers focused on bringing pain awareness in their community. Co-founder of MAPS, a PT-run chronic pain group, and Paradigm Education, a forum for hosting renowned speakers on the subject of pain and self-awareness. Sharna is a member of the OPTA, the Oregon Physical Therapy Association, and has coordinated the OPTA Pain Summit for 2 years, and was recently awarded a grant to raise awareness of opioid abuse, pain awareness, and healthy self-care in the high schools of Corvallis in Oregon. She is a graduate of MS University in India with a degree in physical therapy and is currently on track to finish her transitional doctor of physical therapy this year. She is a certified therapeutic pain specialist and is pursuing her teacher training in mindfulness-based stress reduction from USCD. So I'd like to welcome Sharna.
Thank you, Nick. Okay, let me figure this out. Here, June 28th, 6:50 in the morning. While I was getting ready to go to work with my chai in my hand, I get a text message from my friend, my primary care physician. She's a very caring doctor. A little background, I was diagnosed with a medical condition, and she was a little concerned. And so this is the conversation that takes place on Facebook Messenger. How are you doing, dear? Is the medication agreeing with you? Does it work? I hope you're okay. I think of you often. Thanks, that means a lot to me. The medication's working really well, which surprised me. I'm not a medication person, but it surprised me and it was helping. Going into my healthy lifestyle, we'll see how I manage this. Well, I hope you don't get tachyphylaxis over time, dear. Try to avoid sugar and dairy, the most inflammatory foods. It's hard. So who in this audience knows the word tachyphylaxis? There is a physician in the audience, and that's the only one who knows it. And I have chai. Well, in India, we make chai with milk and sugar. So that was what it was. Now that I'm freaking out, as she's now worried about me getting debilitated as well. So my brain goes into recognizing patterns. Tacky, boom, 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 boom. My heart rate was 150 beats a minute. I know this word, I can fake this. You know how you read a book and you don't know the word and you don't want to go look it up? It's like, I'll figure it out, it's a medical word. Phylaxis, anaphylaxis. I can die from an anaphylactic response. Tachyphylaxis is death. So, I go into my catastrophic mode. Looks like I'm going to die. I better say my goodbyes. I'm not going to see my daughter wearing a salmon-colored dress for her wedding. I started texting them and telling my kids I love them. Just remember all the things I told you, because I'm not going to be there to tell them again. And of course, they never listen anyway, so who cares? Giving extra hugs to my husband and extra treats to my dog. I'm very upset about this. I go to work. I can't talk to anyone about it because I was going to die. So at the end of the day, I'm like, you know, I got to share this. So I showed it to one of my friends and I said, hey, you know what? Oh, sorry, that was giveaway. I said, did you, this is what happened. And she said, Sharna, did you look up that word? And I said, no, why would I look that word up? It's a nocebic word, a harmful word. And she said, okay. Well, I had to put my glasses on to see it. So she said, this is what it is. Turns out tachyphylaxis does not mean I'm going to die, and actually means my medication is going to be less effective eventually. So as providers, what we say to our patients matters. But what matters more is what we say to each other. Now, let me go over the outline of my presentation, because I love puzzles and mosaics. So I'm used to order coming from chaos. As I work on different parts of the puzzle, and sometimes my presentation follow that same pattern, so please bear with me. So just to help you follow my train of thoughts, my focus in this talk is provider to provider communication, but I will be weaving in and out with patient and provider stories. So I'm going to share my chronic pain story and transformation from a biomechanical therapist to a biopsychosocial therapist, followed by the Titanic model, which is a conceptual model of self-care embedded in the polyvagal theory. Thank you, Maxie, for setting the stage up for me. I want to talk a little bit about the opioid epidemic, as this brings on an urgency of why, as providers, we do need to say what we say and collaborate. And then I will be sharing, wait, let me see what this is. I've got to figure this computer out. I'll share how this epidemic has urged us to make some changes in our community. And last but not the least, I will be talking about gurus. That's a Sanskrit word. Brené Brown calls herself, I'm a big fan of Brené Brown as well, Maxie, too. She's a researcher storyteller. Well, I am a clinician storyteller. Okay, so this is going to be a hard story, so we'll bear with me. New York City. I had just moved from India as a young physiotherapist. I was working in acute care, and I was also going to school at that time. I felt a twinge in my neck while helping a patient stand up. That twinge, I didn't think much about it. I was in my early, mid-20s. Don't need to calculate the dates, weight, age, whatever. And that twinge turned into ridiculous symptoms into my hands, both hands tingling and numbness. I wouldn't see a PT because I was the PT. I was supposed to know what to do with conditions like that. I was very frustrated. I would not feel the pain or the discomfort when I would go to work, but I felt it when I was walking home to the bus stop. A couple of my friends recommended take the McKenzie course. Wait, before. I saw a surgeon. The surgeon told me that you need to have surgery. You have a positive MRI with a C5-6 central disc herniation. It was pressing on some of the nerves. It's like a jelly donut pressing on the nerves. And if you don't have surgery, you're going to be paralyzed. Well, fear of being paralyzed. A couple of my coworkers told me, Sharna, take the McKenzie courses. They will help you. So I did. I took A, B, C, D all in 1 year. I was picked as a patient in one of the courses. And they showed me how to move safely. 6 months later, I was pain-free. My belief, McKenzie was the way to be. The jelly-filled donut metaphor became my life. And my patients got better. Of course they did. Fast forward, married, 3 kids, 2013, 2015, agonizing low back pain with ridiculous symptoms in my leg. I would crawl out of bed and go to the gym. I would work out. go to work. I went from a sitting chair to a standing desk because sitting was the next smoking. You remember that time? I was miserable. I thought I was a farce. I thought this profession was fake. How could my patients get better, but I couldn't treat myself? I was burnt out. I did not care if they got better or not. I was just going through the motions. My belief that my jelly-filled donut was totally squished out. I was broken. That's when I met a crazy doctor. Our librarian introduced me to this physician, Dr. Kevin Cucaro. I want to make this very clear. I am not paid to talk about him at all. It's just someone who has helped me on the way. I have to mention it throughout this presentation. So the librarian said, you got to keep asking for the same articles. Meet. So I said, okay, we'll meet. Dr. Cucaro, I was like, what do you do? And he goes, well, I'm pain doctor's interventionist, right? And I'm like, yeah, well, what kind of intervention do you do? And he said, well, I don't do that. I said, what do you do then? And he goes, well, I teach physicians and residents about pain. And I'm like, you know what? And I wasn't very impressed by him. But I was curious. I really wasn't. I was curious. And I kept saying, okay, well, come to our department. You know, we've got about 50 therapists in the department. Come and talk to them. And so he did. And I still wasn't impressed because he was like, yeah, that's all good. But you know what? You're not a PT. You don't know what we do. We're the superheroes. We look at people very differently than you physicians do. Right? There's only one physician, and she's my friend, and I can point to her. But my pain and curiosity, wait. My pain and curiosity kept wanting more. And he kept saying things like, I would rather be financially bankrupt rather than morally bankrupt. And I'm like, wow, this guy is totally crazy. And so I heard his podcast. And one of them, it said, attitudes and beliefs of a therapist affects the patient's pain. Now, I totally wrote him off because he didn't know what he was talking about, that's for sure. So I said, you know what? Frustrated with Kevin and my pain, I went to CSM to be with my tribe of PTs, you know, the people who speak my language. Now I was ready to listen to him. I was ready to learn. I attended Adrian Lau's talk on pain. Some of you might have been there. And the first question he asked, what is pain? I'm like, that's a dumb question, duh. We all know what is pain, right? Say, you get hurt, you have pain. And somebody in the audience, some young PT sitting over there said, pain's about protection. No, it's not. I've been a PT for a gazillion years. I know what pain is. I've had a lived experience. And Adrian kept talking. And I was like, oh my gosh, this is true. Pain is about protection. When did this happen? No, when? Nobody told me about it. I've been going to continuing ed courses all this while. But wait, sorry, what's happening here? My jaw dropped. My brain was spinning. And my head came out of the sand. I was like, oh my gosh, pain's about protection. So I went back to my neck pain. And I'm like, what was happening? What was pain protecting me from? And I realized I was lonely. I had left my parents and I was in New York. I was lonely. My telephone bills were $700. Yeah, we didn't have WhatsApp and all that at that time. Phones by you. That was an error. Never mind. I spent hundreds of dollars in Hallmark cards. My current low back pain had so much to do with conflicting values with my normal American kids versus me being torn between Indian culture expectation, what Indian kids needed to be like. They refused debate clubs, robotic clubs, science fairs, spelling bees, normal Indian kids do. Instead, they picked cheerleading and sororities. Are you kidding me? But I was so conflicted with my parenting skills at that time that I didn't realize that that part was affecting my back so much. My profession was not a farce. I was just plain ignorant. Everything Kevin was trying to tell me started to make sense finally. But I was still confused because my belief system started falling apart. It's like, wait. How am I conceptualizing the jelly-filled donut with attitudes and beliefs of the therapist? Total cognitive dissonance, guys. Total cognitive dissonance. I went from looking under the microscope to a global view, from L2, L3, to looking at the whole person in their environment. My first patient, I'd also taken a class on MI. And what I learned in that CSM class was to shut up and listen. New knowledge. So I come back from a weekend, you know, how you come back from a weekend course and you've learned all these cool things and you want to try it out. So I was like, yeah, I'm going to learn how to shut up and listen. So I take my patient for a 6-minute walk test, and we are walking, and I said, tell me your story. She shares, 20 years ago, her 19-year-old son had committed suicide. And it's his birthday tomorrow. And she starts crying. I stopped breathing. Because I froze emotionally. I was facing one of my biggest fears. But we kept walking. I come back to the gym. And I asked if I could give her a hug. Because I'm a hugger. And we did. We reviewed some exercises, and I told her, memories contribute to the pain experience. Following that, I did not see that patient. 6 months go by. I could not stop around pain signs. I was a voracious reader. Everything that came across me, I was stalking Larma Mosley. Oh my God, he did a video on YouTube. I'm gonna watch that. I was reading his articles. I signed up for EP3. I was David Butler, Larma Mosley. I bought all the books I could find on pain science, and that's all I did. That's exactly what I did. And in a staff meeting, I was told, I was acting as a psychologist. I was making my patients cry. And I was working out of my scope of practice. Coming to find out that the patient I had seen 6 months back, come back and seen the evaluating PT. The patient was upset, as she thought she had already dealt with this issue. All she wanted was treatment for her back. I ask you, when do you get done dealing with the child's loss? I don't know, but I can't even imagine. I could not go to that place of imagining that. I'm going to pause my story. I'm going to tell you guys to take a moment with this word, violate, and just take a moment to write this down. What color is it for you? What does it smell like? What does it feel like? And what's another word for it? What's up? Don't worry, it's going fine. They can hear me. I can yell too. So my coworker, my friend, my buddy. Okay, this is hard for me to share. Accused me of violating her patient that I had seen 6 months ago. This was a very painful experience for me. Not only the words we use with our patients, but how we talk to our providers affects the provider emotionally, as I doubted myself as a PT. And then I was angry, and I fought hard. It was a nasty scenario. Ugly. We went to HR, we went to risk management, and I eventually quit my job. The feedback needs to be such that we do not send our peers to the bottom of the ocean. This was one of the most painful experiences of my life, of my professional life. But it was also one of the best things that happened to me because I no longer belong to that tribe. I had to move on. My purpose, my meaning, my sense of belonging, and my self-worth took me to another clinic. The Titanic model. Due to the pain experience, first as a patient and then as a provider, I came up with the Titanic model, a conceptual model of self-care. See what you think. I am open for criticism. This model is embedded in the polyvagal theory. I did have the courage to send this model to Stephen Porges to see if it was aligned with the polyvagal theory, and he told me it was a lovely and insightful model. So I've got his blessings. It's got roots in Bruce Schneider's book, Leadership. Wendy Shumway is my therapist, who is also my leadership coach. And is by my coworker, friend, and it had to be, we had to come up with models that were aligned with health literacy, that we could explain to our patients at a fifth grade and lower language. It was really important to us. So, a quick overview of the five stages. The bottom one is a victim stage. You're still in the water, that's fight, flight, and anger. And this is how I draw it in the clinic, is self-care, self-compassion, and after that, you get on a log, and that's service, and the last one is win-win, and I'll be talking more in-depth in a second. We're at the bottom of the Atlantic. The words on the top are core thought, core emotion, and core action. So this way, you can follow that. This is the first level of energy, the freeze response, the energy of powerlessness. Your patient is immobilized by fear, has a very hard time moving. There is no point in moving. I can't do it. I don't want to move. We may see the patient sleep long hours. Isolation, loneliness, not belonging, shame. Shame is, I am not good enough. We all face that. Not a good enough mother, not a good enough therapist, not a good enough fill in the blanks. You all have it. We have it at different times. And it's a dissociation, as Maxie talked about, dissociation of body parts. I don't feel my leg. I don't feel my hip. I pick it up and put it on bed. You hear that in the clinic. It's a passive response to life threat. It's the energy of the flu when you're down. The second level is you're still in the water. You're fighting the water. This is mobilization due to fear, the fear of drowning. Anger, that how dare you the Titanic sink? I paid so much for it. Classic fight and flight, the energy of either or. I am right, you are wrong, right? The energy we are seeing in our country. The energy of duality, polarity, catabolic energy, losing. Constructive in a short haul, but cannot be sustained. Active response to danger. What's the first thing you do when your head comes out of water? Thank you. This is self-care, self-compassion. What happens? At this time, you can access that part of a brain that can think. We release the tension, charge of fight flight. This is all about
compassion, self-compassion, self-forgiveness, healthy coping. I am okay, but I cannot help anyone else. At this level, we are aware that others exist, but they are not our concern. This is the level of certainty. In the middle of the Atlantic, I found a lot. I'm safe. Now, I can help someone. This is the space of social engagement, where we make eye contact, we exchange facial expressions, we can hear the other person. This is a place of service. We are open to the world and the person in front of us. We, as therapists, are constantly in service. But a lot of times we're drowning. But that does not become true service. That is lip service. Level five, this is where we put all our lots together and make a raft. This is where we are all winners. Now we can climb out of the water into the raft, huddle together for warmth. We can pull others out of the water into the raft, even if they did not contribute, right? This is the level our attention is organized by the group in which we are a part of. We're able to see that each member brings something unique to the situation, and when we combine our resources, we see how we're able to create something that's bigger, better, and which serves more than just each of us individually. So, the point here is, if you are in service, can you save someone when you are drowning? You cannot. So in order for us to provide service, we have to indulge in self-care and self-compassion. In my violent story, I was at the victim stage for a very short time because I had pain signs in my back, in my pocket. But then I moved to an angry stage. I stayed there for a very long time. I got to self-care by quitting my job. I did not get to service because I never got a chance to find out what it meant. What did that word violate mean to my friend? I was not there to unpack her story because there was a lot in there too. Oh, that was the art made by one of our patients who does wood burning. I think our current medical system is in a victim stage. In the Titanic model, we have an opioid epidemic, and it feels like there's no way out. I will talk about how we can move from the victim stage to a win-win stage. So we're in the middle of an epidemic. It's a very fast epidemic. Doctors are feeling very frustrated. Patients are too. Burnout is everywhere in healthcare. PTs are burning out, physicians are burning out. CDC is calling it an opioid epidemic, but is it? Let's take a moment and put this epidemic aside. Let's call it a typhoid. Let's talk about a typhoid epidemic. Typhoid epidemic, people are dying from, caused by salmonella bacteria transmitted through food and water, and the antibiotic used to treat it is not working. Actually, the antibiotic is at killing people. So what do we go around and say it's an antibiotic epidemic? Or do we still call it a typhoid epidemic? Do we still do public health of educating people? You know, let's get the water and food and all that taken care of. We're missing a big piece of this. And words matter. So if we label it wrong, we're looking at it wrong. It is not, it's not, I'm talking too loud. see where my fears go? I'm talking too loud. Sorry about that. Then I was yelling too, so the poor online people.
Alright, so if you could say something and then people online, if you could tell us if that's better, is that good for you?
Is it better? Guys, is it better? Oh, they won't tell me that. Okay, so, where were we? iceberg. What is underneath it? Biology, psychology, and sociology. The social determinants of health. The CDC reports that the conditions in which we live and work has an enormous impact on our health, long before we ever see a doctor. It's time we expand the way we think about health and include how to keep it. But it's not the condition, it's not only the conditions we grew up in, it's the conditions we practice in. Bullying bosses, organizations that have bullying as a culture, all impact how we deliver our care. If you are a traumatized therapist, just imagine how this can impact the care you deliver. Deaths of despair. How many of you have heard of this? The deaths of despair. Thank you. Angus Deaton, Nobel Prize winner economist from Princeton, has an interesting article on mortality and morbidity of the 21st century from the Brookings Institute. How non-Hispanic white men have a steady rise in mortality in America. Poor health, physical health, mental health, social isolation for multiple reasons, sexual orientation, loneliness, obesity, marriage or lack thereof, poor labor market opportunities, lack of education are some of the leading causes of the rise. Non-Hispanic white men are ending up with suicide, alcohol and drug poisoning, and liver disease. This is not an opioid problem. This is very deep. Opioid was just the gasoline that was thrown on. It's a cultural problem. It's a society problem. This epidemic has hit us hard in Oregon. 500 pregnancies were complicated last year from overdose. We have infants with withdrawals. 57% of 12 to 17-year-olds who misused prescription opioids got it from a friend and a relative. We're sixth in the nation with the substance abuse problem for adolescents, and we are 49th in the nation with resources, and we are first in the nation for 65 and above with the substance abuse problem. And we have 50th in the nation with resources. This is a serious problem. I am raising my kids in Oregon. I love Oregon. So we committed to change, to be the change that we wish to see in this world. We decided to think global, but act local. So what did we do? There was not a PT-led program we could find that we wanted to implement that included all the aspects we thought that was important. So we created one. Movement, mindfulness, and pain science. It's a group program. PT-led only because we couldn't find a psychologist or a social worker who would talk pain. We didn't want our patients to be confused with their language and we were teaching something else. And we wanted to include trauma-informed lens. This was the only article we done with a psychologist and they don't include trauma-informed care. 2 years later, we now have dozens of patients choosing, mark my word, choosing to get off their opioids. We are tracking outcome data and working on alternate payment methodology to get reimbursed for this program. We have participants who have gone through this program and come back and act as peer mentors. These peer mentors are now, we're hoping, that will start going into doctors' offices and be that support for our physicians. Value-based care. We are ready to challenge some of the world-class, national-class programs and have our program and some of the more the bigger institute programs and have a neutral institute evaluate the same outcomes from these programs. Our programs cost $640 for 8 weeks, 2 times a week, 2 hours each. Some of these programs cost, I'm not going to name anyone, $40,000. I'm ready to put my money where my mouth, put my mouth where my money is. High school project. I'm going to let you guys look at this picture. This was drawn by my young patient with vulvodynia. She was a big girl. What do you see? She had a past history of trauma, social isolation, bullying. Look at the body image. She's hiding behind the weight. There is so much more to obesity. Obesity is about protection. It's not just about calories and exercise. Here's a note from one of my students. I was going to read a part of it. Rest easy, knowing you impacted a 17-year-old's life. I'll probably remember you for a while. Thanks for speaking to us with love. These notes are my dopamine. So what did I do? I made a homemade presentation. I took opioid information, put a video in there. I took some pain science, basic Larmer, went into my kids' high school, and I kept getting called last 2 years, over and over. I did about 20 presentations. Not only was our school, my kids' school, the rivalry school was calling me too. So we would talk basketball, and you know, they would be like, oh God, they're from the rivalry school. So it was a great experience. And then they said, we want more. I said, oh, well, they're actually liking this stuff, so let's see. So one of the teachers suggested, why don't you ask for a grant? And I was like, I got issues around writing, so I wasn't going to write any grant, God forbid, you know? So I asked them, would you be willing to write a grant? Piece of cake. So we collaborated. Win-win. She did the writing. We're going to do the work. And now we have an OT in the house, Michael Falcon. He is going to be helping create this curriculum. Five lesson plans, 90 minutes each, in the high school. What are we doing, Bess? We are ready to bring about some behavior change into our community. Mid Valley Pain Alliance, the community and provider alliance, where we present pain science talks once a month, and the community members share their success stories. Communicating with our peers became very important. Because there was a time when we were, I'm right, you're wrong. And we had to change our language. And that became very, and make it more inclusive and a welcoming space. And Maxie just talked about the safe container. We took this container and we, instead of using it in a patient provider context, we took it to a provider context. And yes, when we are talking to a provider, I need to be present. I need to be reflective. I need to be committed and genuine. All four factors. I'm not going into depth because Max is taking care of that. And then to listen. Oh, I love this. The listen is to lean in softly with the willingness to be changed by what we hear. I don't want to listen if I don't want to change my view. I'm not going to talk to you. But if I'm listening, then I better be present and be willing to change my views. Otherwise, what's the point of listening, right? And what is this big talk that we listen to our patients, but we can't listen to clinicians, our peers? Okay. We understand that our clinicians have their favorite techniques. We all have our teddy bears, right? We need to hang on to our teddy bears. We can appreciate our teddy bears, but let's not make it our identity. Because once it becomes our identity, then logic does not work. We need to grow and evolve beyond it. For me, as a PT, it turns up to being movement and touch. every patient is touched and moved, physically and emotionally. Basic human needs. It's about humanity and humility and compassion. Hang on to your teddy bears, but get in the car. We've got a job to do.
I don't know what you're talking about. But when I was ready,
that time, things changed for me, and he became the person who removed the darkness of ignorance for me. It's a relationship of trust, respect, and authenticity. It's such a big word for us. They can come in the form of a teacher, a preacher, or an expert, or a friend, or anybody in this world. You can be my guru, and I can be yours, and you can be someone else. There's a reciprocal learning, and there's a reciprocal remover of ignorance amongst us. Right? So my request is, to appreciate the definition of guru if you choose to use this respected word. Just like we learn how to re-talk pain, rethink this word before you use it. Not that I can change the whole Western world or anyone, but this is just something I feel very passionately about. So I thought I would share. A huge thank you to my gurus, my daughter Risha, who's also some of the reasons why I had back pain, but we all know pain and pleasure are very closely related, right? She has asked me some of the most insightful questions. Mom, why do you invite these people to your house when you're cleaning the house, cleaning the bathroom, yelling at us, yelling at dad? And I'm like, They're my friends. I was like, yeah, they're my friends. But then why are you so stressed out?
Oh, wait, maybe there's something more to it. So she's asked me questions that I've had to reflect and say, well, you know what? Nobody's coming in my house where I have to clean up the house. If they're my friend, they'll accept me for who I am and where I am. Wendy Shumway, my life coach, she asked questions that I have to sit on it for 2 years before I know what she's talking about. And Dr. Kukwara, we've heard about it. All right. I call the Union of Dedicated Providers to rise. I need you guys to stand up and hold your neighbor's hand. I don't care if you know them or not. We have a job to do. Our communities need us. And we need each other. Our kids need us. We are enough. We cannot do this alone. Watch our language. Words like tachyphylaxis and violate are part of our vocabulary. It is our responsibility to make sure the people around us are able to understand our words and teach it back. Let's respect the person we are talking to as they're always fighting their own battles. We see anger, frustration in different forms. Just recognize that it is fear cloaked in frustration. We are all in this world to love and be loved. And it is important to remember we are all doing the best we can. The Titanic model teaches us that self-care comes before service and mindfulness comes before everything. Let's help our providers rise. Let's help them remove the darkness of ignorance but only when they're ready. Let's not forget that our biggest and most effective gurus are our patients and those closest to us. Listen to them. Namaste.
No, you're fine. So we have about 10 minutes for questions. Are there any? Oh, Alice is up and ready. Mike, can you bring the mic up, please?
Hi, I was really impressed by your prevention program in high schools because it touched on something that I've been thinking on and off for a long time, which is that by the time we get to work with people and teach them about the pain stuff and whatever, they have usually already been in pain for a long time. often for years and even decades. And I have often wondered, what if we started educating children in school? Like, what would that do? I don't know. So is anybody working on any kind of prevention?
Well, that's what we're working on. That's what we got this FAC grant for. And Michael Falcon here, the OT, raise your hand, please, so people know who you are. Please talk to him also, because we're doing a lot of work right now. We're making it very meaningful. It's not recall. We're not giving information, because we know that knowledge does not change behavior. We are making it very meaningful for the kids so they can experience it and then see if that helps. And hopefully next year we're going to apply for middle school and elementary school, because I believe that the education system is a very cool way to start getting into our communities and teachers, providing support for the teachers is the other piece that I'm very interested in.
There, we have an online question.
From Brian Rutledge, would Sarah Hogg please proceed to the stage and immediately hug Sharna on my behalf? And will Sharna share her PowerPoint?
I guess it's all shareable, yes.
That's from Mickey Townshend.
Yes, I will share. Just email me, and I will share it with whoever wants whatever, except for my kids' pictures. I guess I should take that out.
Okay. Was your hand up over here for a question? Mike's going to come up with the microphone. He's sneaking up behind you.
When you were talking about considering their violence, did you use the ACEs at all?
Say that again?
Did you use the information on the ACEs?
Yes. ACEs is Adverse Childhood Experience. That is a question. I don't know. How many of you are familiar with ACEs? Well, we've got quite a few. So that is a standard questionnaire for all my patients. In our clinic, for all our group patients, we use the ACEs questionnaire with everyone. Yes, we did look at that. Yes.
Hi, Sharna.
Hi.
I'm all fired up. I think a lot of us are all fired up now. And I've gotten fired up before, and I've, like, burned and crashed. But I built a new plane, and I'm flying a little steadier now. What, for you and your teams, was, like, essential at, like, a personal or interpersonal level in order to kind of build up the programs you've built, besides passion? Because I think we all have passion.
Well, in our community, again, I have to go back to Dr. Cucaro, because he's such a role model for us that we were very lucky in our community to have an expert like him who is all he does is reads articles and just synthesizes it. And just every time we use certain words, he goes, no, I'm going to challenge you on that. Pain's not a thing. Pain's not an it. You know, so he corrects us for everything. So you're welcome to join the Mid-Valley Pain Alliance online. It's, you know, and I don't know how else. We don't do anything online. We're not social media people. We're very community focused. So I'm happy to share whatever we've done with you guys. So feel free to talk. We believe in collaboration. We are not we don't do competition, and there's no scarcity. There is absolutely no scarcity. We're ready to give everything we've got.
Question from online.
Wait for the mic, please. What are your thoughts on Paramahansa Yogananda himself? That is from Nick Yerby.
I have no idea. I'm sorry, I don't know the answer to that question. Yeah, if I don't know.
are there any other questions in the room? Katie, up on the... Mike with the mic.
Gopher online named Mike. Thank you, Sharna. I'm also very excited by your work and inspired to do more in my community. I also work interdisciplinarily, if that's a term. I work closely with psychologists, and we've had an OT who's done mindfulness training and who's done a lot of trauma-based work. So we're all very sensitive to that element. The barriers are, however, in implementing ACEs or some other trauma screener strategy, our psychologist colleagues have voiced a lot of concern about doing that, because what if you get this high score, what do you do with that? And that's pretty tricky in expanding into communities, because like your initial patient case, you might open something up that you don't know you're opening.
Yeah, and that's the fear. I mean, I think Maxie touched on that too, right? We have to take care of our baggage. Well, we have to take care of our ACEs. We have to be aware of what our scores are and what is that, what are we bringing to the table? You know, we're carrying our backpacks. Every one of you have a backpack. In case you think that you don't, you all have a backpack. Different size, different shape, different things inside it. So when you come in with that backpack and you're talking about a patient comes in with a high score, it is almost normalizing it. And I may be wrong, the mental health people will, you know, jump on me, but I don't have that much of a background. But what I do, because we work in rural community, the patients who come to us have scores of 8, 9, 10. We do. And does that mean we send them all to psychologists? We don't have psychologists, sorry. We don't have enough people who are pain aware in our community. So does that mean that we have to deal with all that? And where is our scope and where is our boundary? The only thing I would say is acceptance. Just accept the fact that there is trauma. We don't need to do anything. And that, you know, makes it very simple. I mean, trauma is not simple and trauma is not easy, but the fact that we are all traumatized, there's generational trauma, there's cultural trauma, there's adult trauma. Divorce is a trauma. Surgery is a trauma. And so is childhood abuse. So what are we calling trauma? Everything is a trauma. So I'm sorry, it is trauma. And yeah, so, and we use this model. I just kept it in the back, a transdisciplinary model, which is basically a blend. You know, if a patient comes to me for pelvic floor pain, is also seeing a psychologist who's doing CBT, but does not want to do all the paperwork, but she's doing really well with PT, and I say, well, show me what you're doing with them. And it's like, oh, well, what are the thoughts? Well, you just told me these are your thoughts. Well, just fill it in. We help them. So we're kind of, we work very, in, you know, in this nice, smooth way.
Time for one more question. Jason had his hand up. Is that cool? Okay.
I'm around for the next 2 days. So. 3 days.
I've really enjoyed your talk. And first off, thank you for the whole thing about you can have your teddy bears, but get in the car. I absolutely love that line. You know, because a lot of us have teddy bears.
Yes,
but we can
do.
We've got to go somewhere. And so I loved that. But then I wanted to also thank you for bringing up the word guru in a way that didn't make my skin crawl. Because there's a lot of people that present themselves like, I am a guru. And I've often found that to be a little unsettling because, you know, it seems like it's used to sell things. But now I recognize, but in the way that you reframed it for me, I recognize that there's a lot of gurus in my life that perhaps I haven't recognized and thanked for their contributions to me. And it also occurred to me that intentionally or not, for some people, I may be a guru. And so I really feel like it's incumbent upon me to try to be a good one. So thank you so much for framing that.
Thank you, Jason. Just one thing that when people say, I am a guru, it is not us who decide. It's not the, I am a guru. It's not me who decides that person is a guru. It's the student who decides who is their guru. So that is a flip. So it's not that I am a guru. I'm that's the expert. That's the preacher. That's the teacher. But it's the student who will recognize that person. I am going to look up to Maxie as my guru because she has removed some obstacle, darkness from my life. Shelley is one of my gurus. Joletta is my guru. Lucynthia, there are people who have removed darkness in my life. And I really, darkness of ignorance. I'm very ignorant in a lot of ways.
Wonderful, thank you so much. Yeah, unless you want to jump. No, I'm kidding. Don't jump off. Take the stairs. Okay, so it's lunch now. So again, remember there's options around. I forgot to mention, other than the Hyatt for everyone who needs special dietary things, there are a couple other smaller shops over there along the water if you're interested. And then we will start back up at 2:30. So we'll see you then.